Okay, it's great to have you all here. This is welcome to week six of Fundamentals of Biblical Interpretation. And this week you will be reading chapters 7 and 8 from Ben Witherington's Reading and Understanding the Bible. Chapter 7 talks about ancient societies and cultures, and chapter 8 talks about the four gospels and goes over the fact that they are all structured differently. So let's start by talking about ancient societies and cultures. I think the first thing that I want to mention is the problem with the English word you. Growing up in Belgium, I spoke French, and French has two different words where English only has one. So if I were speaking to one of my friends and it was just one person and I wanted to say something to her and say, "Would you come over here?" something like that, I would use the singular version, which in French is tu. But if I had a whole bunch of friends there and I wanted all of them to come over, I would use the word vous. Would you all come over here, please? And that would be vous. In English, though, we only have you. And so when we translate the Bible, both the Old and the New Testament, Hebrew also, like French, has two different words. Greek also, like French, has two different words for singular and plural. But in English, we only have one. And that means that when we read the Bible, we have a tendency to think that when the Bible says you, it's speaking to I, me, myself, all by myself. And the fact that so many times the Bible is speaking to you, all of you, a whole group of people in community, is invisible to us in English. That means when I do my own translations of the Bible, I usually use the English words like y'all, or I've tried use, even some way to communicate to myself when I reread my own translation that these are plural use, plural second person pronouns, rather than singular. So that's something to be aware of. Maybe you have access to works that will help you to navigate that when you're reading the Bible. But at least you should think, when you're reading the Bible and you see the word you, recognize that it's possible that it means all of you, not just you, the person sitting there reading. The second thing I like to talk about in thinking about ancient cultures is the things that we said in our family when we were raising kids, and the things that my parents said to me when I was being raised. So our family is the Hunt family, but it never occurred to me, and I don't remember my husband ever saying to our kids, "Don't do that. That's not the way Hunts behave." Or, since we live in Michigan, "Don't do that. That's not the way people from Michigan behave." Or, "That's not the way Americans behave." If your parents said something like that to you, or you regularly say things like that to your children, that means you are thinking of your behavior and the way it relates to some community that you're involved in. Whether it's, "Don't behave that way, that's not the way Christians behave." Now you're thinking of your church community. "Don't behave that way, that's not the way your family name behaves." Now you're thinking of your family community. Maybe you have a national community, maybe you have a tribal community, but if that occurs to you to think that way, my behavior reflects on how people see my community, that is more of a communal understanding of identity, and that is much more what the people that the Bible was written by and to, the way those societies functioned. And so it's important to think about that, because when we read the Bible again, it is speaking from and to communities that thought of themselves in these more group ways, rather than thinking of individual identities. There's a book called Misreading Scripture with Western Eyes that does a really good job of pointing out several passages in the Bible that we in the West have a tendency to misread. Another way to correct that vision is to read commentaries that are written by people who are not in Western culture and therefore approach the Bible with a different mindset and can give us insight into what the Bible might have meant at the time in ways that we are going to miss. Now, I will mention that I disagree very much with the authors of Misreading Scripture with Western Eyes on their interpretation of David and Bathsheba. I think that they overlook 2 Samuel 11:4 and 12:3 and what that means to the story of David and Bathsheba. And if you want to know more about that, you can ask me in the comments and I will discuss that further. Chapter 8 in Dr. Witherington's book talks about the four Gospels, and he goes through the Gospels and talks about the ways that they are structured differently. So one of the discussions that happens surrounding the four Gospels is, how do we understand what actually happened when we have four, in places, quite different accounts about Jesus's life on earth? And one of the ways that I've heard it explained is, if you think about witnesses to, let's say, a car accident, if four different people sit down with the police and give eyewitness accounts, they are not likely to be the same. And that is a helpful explanation for the four Gospels, except that it's more complicated than that. Because three of the Gospels, Mark, Matthew, and Luke, do have places where they're exactly the same. They're word for word the same. So if you are sitting down and getting eyewitness accounts from this accident, you would absolutely expect to get 3, 4, 5, 6 different accounts, although there would be some similarities. However, you would not expect any two people to explain things absolutely word for word the same. In fact, you might get a bit suspicious if that happened. And so that get a bit suspicious is one of the things that has happened in scholarship. And scholars have asked, how is it that there are places in the three synoptic gospels where the story is told with exactly the same words, even though in so many places it's different? So for example, Mark 10, 13 through 16, Matthew 19, 13 through 15, and Luke 18, 15 through 17 tell the story of Jesus with the little children. And all three of them say, truly I tell you, or report Jesus as saying, truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. Actually, they don't all three say that. I'm sorry. Let me back up. All three of them say, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. And Mark and Luke say, truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. But Matthew doesn't. Matthew says exactly the same words in the previous verse, let the little children come to me, but then he leaves out that second piece. Anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. And so scholars look at those places where the synoptic gospels are exactly the same and places where they're different, and they ask themselves, well, what causes that difference? Now, there's a reason that they do that. So here's how looking at these variations can help us. If we know who wrote it down first, and we know who was copying it over, then we can look at the differences and we can say, oh, Matthew left out that phrase, and maybe he left it out because, and we look at the greater context of Matthew, and we understand better why Matthew told the story in the way Matthew did, based on the pieces that he copied over verbatim and the pieces that he left out. Now, this is called the synoptic problem. If you look, I posted a graph of the synoptic problem. This is from Wikipedia, and it's actually the best graph that I've found on this relationship between the synoptic gospels. What we find is that 76% of Mark has been taken over by Luke and Matthew exactly. And scholars suggest that it was Mark that was written first. And that's why I put it that way, that Luke and Matthew seem to have taken over 76% of Mark exactly the same. Now Matthew takes an additional 18% of Mark that Luke doesn't take, and Luke has just 1% or 3% of Mark, 1% of Luke, that he takes over that Matthew doesn't take. And that makes sense. If Luke and Matthew both have access to Mark, there's going to be a big chunk that they're going to use that's going to be similar, but then Matthew is going to choose some things from Mark that Luke isn't going to pick, and Luke is going to do the same thing. The question that arises, though, is that 23% of Luke and 25% of Matthew are exactly the same and different from Mark. So the question comes up, where did Luke and Matthew get that? And there are two basic solutions that are proposed. The most common proposal is that there was another gospel circulating at the time, and that Luke and Matthew both had access to that gospel and Mark did not. Now, that proposal came out of Germany, and the word in German for source is Quelle, and it starts with a Q. And so that's where this idea of a Q gospel, Q as a source for the gospel, came, is out of this place where Matthew and Luke say exactly the same things and clearly didn't get it from Mark. Mark Goodacre, however, proposes a different theory. He proposes that Matthew had access to Mark, and that Luke then had access to Mark and Matthew, and that Luke therefore took over some of Matthew and pulled from Matthew as well as from Mark. After all, Luke says that he consulted a lot of different sources, a lot of eyewitnesses, in order to write his account. So those are some of the discussions surrounding the gospel and trying to come up not only with solutions for how we got three different gospels that were that are so similar in places and then very different in others, but also not just solving that problem for the sake of solving it, but solving that problem for the sake of then bringing that information to our interpretation of the gospels. If we know, let's say Luke was looking at Mark and Matthew, if we can look at the things that Luke chose to write and the things that Luke chose to leave by the wayside, that can help us to understand the point that Luke was trying to make in the way that he told his story. I want to mention one other thing in talking about the Gospels. I want to talk for a few minutes about the idea of Messiah. You may know that Messiah, our word in English, Messiah, comes from the Hebrew word for anointed one. And our word Christ is a different word in English, but it comes from the Greek word for anointed one. So Messiah and Christ are essentially the same word. They've just come to us in English through two different source languages. It was originally a reference to kings, and in later Jewish writings it was used in a variety of ways, and it was explained with references to a certain set of Old Testament Testament texts. So, if I were doing research and I wanted to know what the word Messiah means, I would be likely to go through the Old Testament and look for all of the places where the word Messiah is used and find out how it was used in the Old Testament in order to understand what it means in the New Testament. However, a man named Matthew Novenson did a study, and he approached the study differently. He asked not what does the Old Testament say about the word Messiah, but what were Jews at the time of Jesus saying about the word Messiah? And he discovered that there was a certain list of Old Testament texts that were generally referenced when Jews of the first century talked about Messiah. And they aren't necessarily ones that actually use the word Messiah. His book is called Christ Among the Messiahs. And the verses that he saw that came up regularly are Genesis 49:10, Numbers 24:17, 2 Samuel 7:12-13, Isaiah 11:1-2, Amos 9:11, and Daniel 7:13-14. And I invite you to look those up and kind of get a feel for what these verses are saying about the Messiah. Because what they help us to do is understand why the discussions surrounding Messiah in the whole New Testament sort of proceeded the way they did. What we find is Paul, for example, emphasizes the obedience of the Gentiles to Christ. And that connects very nicely with the ways that these particular Old Testament texts explained what was going to happen when Messiah came. One of the things they say is that the Gentiles will come to believe in the God of Israel. However, when you read those texts, you'll also find that they had to explain how Jesus' death on the cross fit into the picture of conqueror and liberator that's clearly also part of this idea of Messiah. And so the question New Testament writers and early Christians had to answer was, how could Jesus be the Messiah when he didn't bring liberation to the people of God? Oscar Skarsson has a book called In the Shadow of the Temple, and he also addresses some of these issues, and he suggests that there might be three different answers that early Christians found for this question. The first answer is that liberation will happen at Jesus' second coming, and I think we're familiar with that answer. The second answer is that liberation happens now, as Jesus sits at God's right hand. And so, for example, if we interpret idolatry as bondage to demons, as some New Testament texts seem to, then we see that even now, Jesus, in his death and resurrection, has liberated people from bondage to demons. So we have that kind of liberation. We also see New Testament authors arguing that liberation began when Jesus was anointed in baptism, with references particularly to Isaiah 61:1. So we see in the New Testament Jesus proclaiming the kingdom, Jesus doing miracles, and also the idea that his suffering and death was part of his messianic work, with John the Baptist as an Old Testament prophet doing the anointing. And perhaps we might also see all three of these answers, with liberation happening in stages, to show that Jesus is indeed the Messiah, connecting the idea of Messiah back to the ways that early Christians and first century Jews would have understood this word Messiah. So that's what I had to share with you today. I hope that's interesting and helpful to you as you read the New Testament and as you read Dr. Witherington's book this week. Take care.